While the Lucadors entered my collection and immediately started taking names in three-player games, the Incas entered my collection, got with three good partners, and fielded a rather insane 15-3 win-loss record in 1v1 games to jump pretty close to the top of my standings. Play action on base looked like a pretty mediocre strategy in 1v1 until the Inca's release, with the Dragons sort of indicating that since these guys have some powerful VP cards, maybe there's a limit to how good this can be. But the Incas, with a little bit more mobility and a little bit more ability to build up and slowly overload defenses, demonstrate that it's actually possible for this strategy to be very high tier, rather than just pretty good. Dragons avoided getting shut down by Swarm via two incredible anti-Swarm minions in Hatchling and Imperial Dragon that unfortunately also limited how good the Dragons would be with three or more players by encouraging opposing players to play on bases where they didn't see a Dragon's minion. However, outside of opposing Swarm decks, Dragon's decks tends to struggle against some of the other absolute top 1v1 archetypes they might have to face. Geeks decks are good at placing their actions somewhere useless. Aliens decks just play the control game better and will often terraform away a critical action. And Cthulhu T-type Madness decks take advantage of the fact that the Dragons want to use their actions and often don't have time to get rid of Madness. Incas don't seem to have these problems. Versus Geeks with their counterspells and rules lawyers, the Incas have the capacity to get around rules lawyer with a solid movement package, including 4 copies of Llama and 1 copy of Golden Condor, which typically are enough to mean that rules lawyer doesn't really solve problems for the Geeks at all, because the Incas are more than happy to put the action back where they wanted it in the first place. As far as the counterspells, the Incas spread their power out among a bunch of pretty good actions rather than having one super broken action like Terraform that can get shut down by force of will. As a result, the Geeks tend to get overloaded with little threats to hit their counterspells and can't stop everything. As far as control minion, well, the Incas spread their minion utility out among all 4 of their minions as well, and because of this, the Geeks don't have a great target for control minion. So the Geeks package ends up surprisingly ineffective at stopping Incas. By the way, when I talk about lots of small cards contributing to the Incas' power attack with their actions, the Truckers also have the same trait. It's just that the Truckers on their own, and the Truckers also have a good movement package, the Truckers just aren't quite powerful enough, they don't do enough quickly enough, to be a huge threat to the Geeks in the first place. Incas claim a good matchup against aliens for 2 reasons. The first, that return minion to hand is pretty ineffective against the Incas. Their minions all do fun things either every turn or on coming into play, and so, like the Elder Things, the Incas are happy to see their minions go back to their hand, they'll just play them again. And the second reason is that the Incas are pretty good at resetting their hand after getting bombed out by a Terraform that drops all their stuff in their discard pile, which is still a threat. Every deck in 1v1 fears a Terraform unless they are holding Force of Will or Will Wheaton in their hand. But relatively speaking, the Incas are pretty good at coming back from it, assuming, you know, you use this card enough, the one I'm showing on screen ever since I started talking about resetting from a Terraform. Versus Rush or Madness Spam decks, I'm a little bit less confident in the Incas' abilities. Inca Dragons did a fantastic job of making a Robots deck look stupid, but that was Inca Dragons, not Incas with a partner faction that isn't designed specifically to punk robots. Incas don't really have much in the way of anti-rush features, other than the fact that they can set up with relatively low amounts of power in play until they're almost ready to go off and hit a deck hard. They've got ways to spread their actions out and, you know, not play the armory too soon, and have various ways that maybe they can use Golden Condor or Llama to suddenly line up a couple of armories later and turn a low power setup into a big power break. This in turn makes it so that rush decks don't do a fantastic job of base breaking their setup out of play, but still, rush decks are not as comfortable a matchup for Incas relative to how good rush decks are in general as aliens or geek decks would be. And rush deck segues me nicely into games with three or more players. These are not the Inca's forte, although I believe they're still better than most factions in a three-player game. The issue they have here is a lot of their cards are a little bit setup-focused, and it takes them some time to get going. If it takes you a little bit time going in a three- or four-player game, you might get punched out at a couple bases until you're ready to really compete for those points, and that might leave you too far behind to catch up to 15. Also, when there's two or three players acting in between your turns, if you're halfway set up and your opponents all recognize that you might just win the game if you get one more turn, it's pretty easy for two or three players to go, oh god, we need to break these specific bases and get this setup off the board, and next thing you know, all your setup is gone before your next turn. Every setup deck has issues with this in three and four player games. Although, again, it depends on if you have a group of opponents who all have the danger signal go off in their head on the same turn or not. If their danger signals go off on different turns and they don't coordinate, you may get away with setting up in a three-player game when you really have no business getting away with it. And the final matchup issue for Incas is dealing with Madness Spam decks. And when I look to see what do they have for dealing with Madness Spam, they really only have one tool, and that is Child of the Sun. If they're facing a Madness Spam deck that doesn't have enough power drop to also contest bases hard at the same time, they may be able to do some shenanigans involving using Child of the Sun's extra actions to set up while returning a Madness every turn at the same time, and that should be a winning strategy in that matchup. However, this also means that Child of the Sun is going to be a Kennedy to Corruption, and I think this is overall a little bit more questionable matchup for the Incas than Aliens or Geeks decks would be for them. It's maybe not quite as questionable as some of the Rush decks, but I would be a little bit scared of a good Madness Spam deck playing Inca unless I have a partner that brings extra actions. And of course, extra actions tend to be the win button against Madness Spam decks. When it comes to playing the Incas, I think they require a little bit of planning and skill to get the most out of them, probably a little bit more than most factions. The first thing you want to be looking for, especially in 1v1, is that you want at least one good run out of Temple of the Sun in every Incas game. That is what will give you enough cards and enough options to use your self combo tools to start dropping amounts of power that actually scare people. Temple works with the rest of your draw and search engine in order to grease the wheels of the Inca power engine, and so a lot of the time you'll be hunting for temples with Incan Engineer, who also helps keep your deck going. Temple of the Sun is often the number one priority card I pull for with Sapa Inca as well, and it's often also what I go for with Ashlar Masonry, especially if I'm trying to overwhelm a Geek's deck over time with too many threats, because if I get the temple card draw, then I'm going to have enough little threats to throw that the counterspells don't do much, whereas if I go directly for a big power drop, they can just counterspell the big power drop. On the other hand, if I'm not specifically trying to overwhelm an opponent with small threats, Ashlar Masonry might be better used on part of my power engine. Now, your power engine primarily base breaks, at least manages tough base breaks, with the help of two cards, Child of the Sun and Armory. Child of the Sun double action drop can come out of nowhere, and if it's something crazy like Child of the Sun double armory on a base that had two actions already, that's 18 power all of a sudden. That base is breaking. On the other hand, if you can pull off a base break using an Incan Engineer or a Sapa Inca to break the base, that's really nice because the search might help you snowball into the next base faster, or of course you might use Child of the Sun for a base break when you don't need the extra action just because, then you can start to play a fresh action on the next base and start to snowball off that base break as well. When you're playing against an Inca's deck, Child of the Sun and Armory are also the cards you would really like to snipe or get rid of. If you have an opportunity to probe a Child of the Sun out of hand, do it. If you have the opportunity to destroy a Child of the Sun in play, you should typically do that, because that card makes Incas bursty. Without it, they aren't really bursty at all. They're more of a mediocre speed setup faction. And the Armories, as an Inca player, you know, both Child and Armory, you should try to avoid exposing them to destruction unnecessarily when facing decks that have it, because if you're facing players that know how your deck work, they want to take out those linchpins of your deck. You also have a slower base breaking tool in Fortress Walls, which is great for a couple of reasons. First, it helps make your minions hit breakpoints where they're out of range of specific opposing destruction cards, which again, in some matchups, is a fantastic thing to do. You know, having a lot of 4-power minions against ninjas makes the ninjas very unhappy. Same deal against aliens. If everything has 4-power, a bunch of their cards are dead in hand. Fortress Walls is also nice because it lets you slowly build up power in a way that will be more extra power next turn than it is this turn, which means that the turn before you're ready to break the base is sitting farther from the breakpoint, and you can still break it, which makes it harder for one or more opponents to break the base out from under you before you're ready to break it. So Fortress Walls is your nice setup card. This is the sort of card that I think the designer sort of learned about a bit over time is really nice to have. We saw a little bit of it in Truckers, and I think sort of the Truckers idea of some of the slow setup cards comes into its own a lot better with the Fortress Walls as the one setup card, whereas you have the big power drop card in Armory that's paired alongside it, so that you have that option for setup versus big power. Your other tool for avoiding getting bases broken out from under you is your movement package. And technically you could include Royal Highway in this, but I find Royal Highway is more useful as just action count on base, drawing a card from Temple of the Sun, adding an extra 2 power to a future Armory, things like that. You can play Royal Highway to make your opponents waste time thinking about if you have an interesting play available with Royal Highway, but usually since you know you have other better cards in your hand, you know that you have better things to do than actually attempt to use Royal Highway most of the time. However, Llama is really useful for doing something like evacuating Temple of the Sun from a base before you break it so you can start abusing it again, or playing one action at an sort of off-center base that isn't the main one you're targeting so that there's less power on there, and then on the break turn maybe you just play a Llama and it moves to where it needs to be. Or you can just get an extra counter out of Fortress Walls if you're setting up at 2 bases on the same time. Llama gives you a lot of options to play on multiple bases at the same time, which you often do when you're not playing against gimmick decks and you're actually more playing a game of smash up. Some of those tricky matchups against rush decks, you're going to have to use your Llamas in order to get through those. And the big brother of Llama is, of course, Golden Condor, who can do some very abusive things if you're left in a good position. If your opponents leave you in a good position where you have 3-4 actions in play at the same time, Golden Condor might end up reading, draw 3 cards, put 2+1 counters on a minion here, and replaying the Armory doesn't do anything. But we also triggered our Child of the Sun, so yeah, this base is breaking and we're drawing 3 cards at the same time. On the other hand, if you don't have an already advantageous position, it doesn't tend to do much. Basically, Golden Condor is the card that you can sometimes use to deliver a knockout blow when you're already a bit ahead. Signs in the Stars is a very interesting little card that's probably not very good. It has a lot of little uses. If you're going to fish for a specific base ability, you probably want to go for base abilities that help you break bases rather than that stop you from breaking bases, because your opponents will just turn the top base face down if they don't want to see it. Most of the time, though, I would rather use Signs in the Stars if I can stick it somewhere and my partner faction has a card that replaces the base with the top card of the base deck, I can use this to know what I'm going to get so that that card can be a lot more useful. Or alternatively, if I'm significantly ahead or behind in a 1v1 game, I can either fish for a 3-1-1 base if I'm behind and need time to catch up before my opponent hits 15, or fish for a 4-3 or a ninja base or something like that if I'm ahead and want to get to 15 before my opponent can catch up. And finally, we have the lessons that the developers learned from steampunk, one of which I think is that scrap diving is just kind of too slow a card to be all that good, because a lot of the time while you're trying to use it, someone else is actually breaking a base. Well, your substitutions for scrap diving are quite a bit better. Ashlar Masonry doesn't use an action play, so it's just an action play faster, and it also serves the function of putting more useful actions back into your deck rather than having them sit in the discard pile. And Khipu Strings is also just straight up an action faster than scrap diving because it plays the action at the same time. So these cards, and you know, dragons have a similar card that searches out and plays the card at the same time. These cards will just help your deck run more smoothly, and a lot of the time you're going to be fetching either temple or armory based on what kind of a deck you're playing against and whether you need to go for slow overwhelm or break a base now. I think at this point I've covered every card in the Incas deck. I've found this to be a very fun as well as a pretty powerful faction, and I hope you guys have as much fun playing Incas in Smash Up as I have. Happy smashing, everyone.